This is the project that I've been working on for a few weeks. A homemade portable soldering iron. For this project, I've designed the board, select the components, solder everything, program the temperature control and design the 3D printed case. And this is the final result. The board uses the Atmega 328 microcontroller, has an OLED screen, some push buttons for control and can reach over 480 degrees. Of course, this is version 1.0 and I'm sure that I will make more versions in the future. But in this video I will show you how I've made this one, so let's get started. This project is brought to you by JLCPCB, which is a manufacturer of quick PCB prototypes for more than 10 years and is the site that I use for all of my PCBs. Once designed, upload your gerber files on the JLCPCB site. Get a full review of the PCB, select your desired settings and order the PCB for amazing prices. I've ordered 10 of my prototype PCBs for only $2 and received those in 6 days. Crazy, right? So order your quality PCB and make your projects look a lot more professional. What's up my friends, welcome back! Since my past review of the TS100 soldering iron, I've been working on my own portable soldering iron. So I've made some tests, some research, created the PCB and finally made this project. So we need a heating element to heat the iron, of course. And this type of ceramic heater will do just fine. But we also need a thermocouple to read the real temperature value and then create the PID control. But using a thermocouple is not that easy, so we also need a thermocouple amplifier IC. I've used the MAX6675, so I've bought the SMD IC so I could place it on my own PCB. This chip has an SPI port, so I could communicate with it and get the real temperature value. Okay guys, we also need to control the power applied to the heating element. So for that I've used this big N-channel MOSFET, and I will control it with a PWM signal. Finally, to merge everything together and control the temperature, I've used the Atmega 328 microcontroller that will work at 16 MHz. The board that I've made also has two push buttons, so I could set the temperature, activate sleep mode or start heating the iron. The main input is up to 24 volts, so since the digital part of the board works at 5 volts, I've used this very small buck converter in order to obtain 5 volts. And that's it! These are all the blocks of the PCB and the case of the iron. So, before we start, let me just show you what we will achieve. This is my final board for my project. I power it with 14 volts in this case using this plug and the LiPo battery. First, we get the logo on the screen, and then the iron starts in sleeping mode. It tells me to press any of the buttons. Once the button is pressed, the iron starts heating up. We can see the set temperature but also the real temperature. Now, long press one of the buttons and we can increase or decrease the set value up to 480 degrees. Stop pressing the button and after 1 second the new set temperature gets saved and the real temperature starts increasing. Press both buttons at the same time for a second and the iron enters into sleeping mode once again. And from here, if we want, we do this once again. Okay guys, so we know the blocks we need for this soldering iron. Let's start with the heating element. I first thought on how to implement the tip using this kind of heaters and join this with my iron tip. But then the easiest option was to buy this kind of 24 volt soldering iron for only $5. This already has all that I need. Let me open this commercial iron. Inside, we have the heater that already has the thermocouple inside. So, we have these 5 wires. 2 for the heater resistance, 2 for the thermocouple and 1 more for the earth connection. First step is to find which is the positive and negative wire of the thermocouple. The heater has no polarity. Okay, so for that I've connected the black and red wires, which in case of the used iron were yellow and blue, to this K-type thermocouple thermometer. If you get a good read, now you know which is the positive and the negative wire. I will cut this board and the wires and I will solder those to my PCB later. Okay guys, next let's solve the voltage regulation problem. the input for this board could be from 12 volts up to 24 volts. But we need 5 volts for the microcontroller, the OLED screen and other components, and an LDO would be the worst option here. So for that I will need a buck converter. In order to not complicate my board too much, I've used this commercial module that already has a coil and a buck converter driver. But before I connect this to my board, first apply 12 to 24 volts to the input, and then adjust the potentiometer till you get around 5 volts. Now I've placed hot glue on the potentiometer, so I make sure that the voltage won't change by mistake and burn my controller. Finally, test the voltage once again and see if it changes with the input. If not, you are good to go. To program the microcontroller, I've used the wired port. So I need an FTDA module like this one, that will be connected to these pins here on my PCB. So guys, this is the final schematic for this project. You have everything below, ready to download. You have the schematics, the gerbers for the PCB, a part list and the STL files for the 3D printed case. So now this is the final layout of the board. We start with the 5525 DC plug, followed by the input and output pins from the buck converter with a voltage of 5 volts and the 16 MHz crystal in the middle. Then we have the Atmega 328 microcontroller, the push buttons for control, the thermocouple read IC and the MOSFET on the bottom side of the PCB. As extra components we have the input diode and the diode for the MOSFET here, the crystal oscillator of 16 MHz that we talked before and the capacitors. We also have some pull-down resistors for the buttons and 4 pins for the I2C communication for the OLED screen. Here, in the middle, I have some holes for a hall sensor, but this will be for a next version. With this sensor I could later adapt the code and put the iron into sleep mode if not used for 2 or 3 minutes. Okay, so I've ordered the PCBs and received them in around 10 days. I gather all the components and start building the project. I first soldered the Atmega chip in place. See the dot on the PCB and on the chip in order to know the first pin. I also soldered the crystal and the capacitors to make it oscillate, the 10K pull-up resistor connected to the reset pin and the 100 nanofarad capacitor between DTR and reset pins. This is all that we need to test if the controller works, and it's also called a bare minimum configuration of the Atmega chip. You have more information below. Now, if your chip doesn't have a bootloader, you should burn one before, using these connections that you could find below and with an Arduino Nano board. See my other video on how to burn the bootloader to an Atmega 328. You could also buy directly a chip with a bootloader or just take one out from an Arduino Nano using your hot air gun. In this way, you can make sure that the chip already works. Okay, at this moment I could connect the FTDA chip and upload the test sketch and see if it works by checking the serial monitor. I've done that, and now that everything works I keep soldering the components. I soldered the MAX 6675 chip, that will give me the real temperature. Then I soldered the OLED screen, the push buttons, the MOSFET and all the extra components. I had to change a few SMD capacitors, because the value wasn't good enough and the frequency was affected, so I've used these ones which are through hole. Then I've made the connections to the heater and the thermocouple and start making some tests. Once I was sure it will work, I've soldered the buck converter and the board is now ready. There are a lot of steps for this project, so make sure you visit the link for electronoobs.com in order to read and see more details. If you want to do this step by step, below you have these 3 extra schematics. One is just for the thermocouple read with the MAX 6675 module. The other is for OLED screen example, and the third is for power control applied to the heater using the MOSFET. You also have an example code for each, for temperature read, OLED data write and PWM control of the MOSFET. By the way, make sure you install the MAX 6675 and the OLED libraries before compiling the code. Links for that are below. Now I connect the FTDA module and start coding. The code is easy. Read all the comments in the code to understand more and also look at my PID temperature controller video. But the idea goes like this. We start in sleep mode. Then we press any of the buttons and get out of the sleep mode, and then create a PID code. In this loop we read the temperature using the SPA communication, calculate the error and finally get the PID value. Next, we write a PWM signal to the MOSFET connected on pin D3. And that's it! But also in the code there are some small ifs that will increase or decrease the set temperature value, or start the sleep mode. Okay, so I upload the code and give it a test one more time. I connect 24 volts at the input and the iron works very well. I get the logo, then the sleep mode message. I press the button and select the maximum temperature. The iron gets at 480 degrees with no problems. I also connected the oscilloscope to the MOSFET gate. And as you can see, when the set temperature is almost reached, the PWM width gets lower. And that's how the PID works. I've shortened the stock wires and soldered the heater to my PCB. Now I prepare the case. For that, I first cut the plastic case of the other iron that I've bought. I then designed and 3D printed a case for the electronics. The case is made out of two parts and two buttons. I used this plastic part from the commercial iron because it's more heat resistant and already has the part where I can screw the tip. I passed the wires through this plastic part and soldered those on my PCB. I removed the wired cable since the iron is already programmed and tested once again with voltages from 12 to 24 volts. I get the 3D printed case. I fit the PCB inside and the size is perfect. When I'm sure that everything is okay, I use a bit of hot glue. I add the small plastic buttons and close the top part. And there you have it. I've got myself my own homemade portable soldering iron. Let's talk a bit about it and future improvements. First of all, with a battery of 14 volts, I couldn't reach the maximum temperature. But with 24 volts, I had no problems. Other disadvantage is the bad quality of the iron metal tips, because it is very cheap. The heater gets quite hot, but the heat is not well transferred and you end up with a bad iron. I would like to use these tips for my TS100 iron, but only one problem. The thermocouple of this iron tip is in series with the heater, so measuring the temperature is way more difficult, so I have to redesign my project. Maybe if I use a better iron like this Yuhua one, I could get better results, but also increase the price. But I think I will make more research and test it with the TS100 tip, because it is very high quality and works very well and very cheap. Also, next version will have the hall sensor and a magnet on the stand, so I could implement an auto sleep mode in the firmware. So there you have it, my friends. You have all the files below and on my webpage, electronoobs.com. Check the tutorial there with details and photos, and also a comment section if you have any doubts. So that's it for today. I hope that you enjoyed this project. If so, don't forget to click the like button like crazy and share this video with your friends. If you have any question about this video or any other, just leave it in the comment section below or my Q&A page. Also, don't forget to subscribe and watch all of my other great tutorials. And remember, if you consider helping my projects, check my Patreon page as well. Thanks again and see you later, guys.